We meet an old, decrepit lady alone in her living room. It's hard to tell exactly what's wrong with her, but there's a black box with some markings on it sitting on a mantle that seems to be upsetting her. Voices whisper in her head, and she bravely picks up a hammer and walks to the box, clearly intent on destroying the thing. But the voices grow louder, and soon, well, soon she's being tossed about the room like a rag doll. It's disturbing stuff. Legs are snapping, bones are breaking, walls are cracking as she's thrown into them. And by the time it's over, she's a broken, near-dead mess on the floor. Her son then arrives home to find the aftermath. Clyde Brennick is a high school basketball coach, and we meet him training the team, proving himself to be an all-around, likable character. But then he arrives home, only for us to realize that he's going through the middle of a divorce and his wife, Stephanie, might not agree with that previous character assessment. Things are pretty tense between him and Steph, made more so by her new boyfriend, Brett, who's hanging about like a bad smell. But it's not all that bad for Clyde. He has two daughters, and it's his weekend with them. The youngest of his daughters is Em, a sweet and kind girl trying to encourage others to become vegan like her. The other daughter, Hannah, is slightly older, and her biggest concern right now is straightening her teeth. They seem like a happy little family, though, despite the impending divorce. To his daughter's surprise, Clyde has bought a new place for them to all stay in. It's slightly out of town on a new reservation, but it's big and new and open. And despite Hannah's reservations, it's clear that it's a pretty nice spot. Em in particular seems to really like it. They have pizza for dinner, and later that night, Clyde tells Em some bedtime stories. The point here is that they're all rather happy and normal, at least for now. Things take a slight turn the next day when Clyde and his daughters head across the road for a yard sale. That same black box from the first scene catches Em's eye, and although it seems innocuous enough, we can't blame Clyde for letting her buy it. We know different. And this is confirmed a moment later when Em is walking past the window of a house holding the box, and the old lady from the first scene sees it and begins to freak out. Before we go on, like the video, smash the subscribe button, turn on that notification bell, or Slender Man will haunt your dreams. Like really, loses her mind at the mere sight of the box. So meanwhile, Clyde is offered a job coaching a higher league basketball team, but in another state, essentially leaving his family behind. Despite this, he couldn't be more interested in the job. Now the box is locked up tight, and it's hard to open. Em has to get Clyde to open it for her, but he's too busy and gets distracted. So later that night, Em finds a secret latch that opens the box. Inside are a bunch of dead moths, a ring that she puts on, and a few other random trinkets. There's also a mirror in the box's lid. Now Em falls asleep with the box open beside her and is awoken early the next morning to terrified screams of Hannah. She and Clyde run to see what's wrong, only for it to be revealed that there's a moth in her bedsheets. It's as middling a problem as there could be, and Clyde kills the moth, which only upsets his two daughters. Something's definitely wrong with Em. Her sister dancing, trying to raise the mood, but Em says that she feels funny, playing with the ring still on her finger. She tells Hannah that she doesn't feel like herself, and Hannah thinks it's to do with the parents getting divorced. She tells Em to just stop giving a well, bad advice. So on the next day, Clyde drops his daughters back off at his ex-wife's house. She chastises him for not being a good father, and he's forced to watch as his ex, her new boyfriend Brett, and his daughters sit down for a family dinner without him. It's a reminder that maybe his wife isn't so far off the mark. Now on the next weekend, Clyde picks his daughters up and brings them back to his house. But when they get there, something's wrong. There's a noise coming from within the house. And as they creep further in, they see the place has been trashed. Ominous music's playing, the camera pans, and something's about to happen. Ah, just a raccoon. So as Em is sleeping that night, the box whispers to her. We don't understand what it's saying, but it has a hypnotic effect on Em. And in the morning, as she's eating breakfast, she stabs at her pancakes and shovels them into her mouth in a monotonous manner. When Clyde barks at her to stop, she stabs his hand with a fork. She instantly snaps out of the moment and tries to apologize, but the damage is done, and he sends her to her room. So now she's sleeping again later that night, and the box can be seen opening on its own behind her. Meanwhile, Hannah brushes her teeth in the bathroom only to open the medicine cabinet and find it filled with moths. She screams and Clyde comes rushing, but it only gets worse from there. They see moths pouring out of Em's room, and when they open the door, there are indeed hundreds of them. They all surrounded Em, who sits in the middle of the room in a trance-like state. Clyde carries her out, moths aplenty fluttering overhead. Unfortunately for Clyde, this sudden infestation means that his daughters have to go back to their mothers, which leaves Clyde alone for the week. He clearly has some trouble passing the time, but still somehow manages to miss Hannah's performance. He also examines the black box, but is just as confused as we are by what he discovers. So now Em's in the bathroom at home getting ready for bed. But something isn't right. She can feel something in her throat. And when she opens to have a look, a bug of some sort sticks its tentacles out above her tongue. She panics, but then looks again, and it's gone. So the next day in class, a boy sitting just behind Em reaches across and steals her bag when she isn't looking. He opens it to find the black box, and when Em sees him, she freaks out. She's screaming at him to give the box back. And then she starts to slap him. She goes to punch him in the face, but her teacher stops her just in time. Now her parents meet with the principal and teacher, who informs them that Em has started to change as of late. She's distant, not finishing her assignments, and just not herself. Steph is thinking the divorce might be the reason, and later on she accuses Clyde of checking out and being responsible for all of this. He tries to deny it, but when she brings up his new job offer, one which would see him leave town and his family, he has nothing to say back. Now that night, Em's teacher's alone in the classroom with the box. She tries to open it, and that's when things become strange, or rather terrifying. Blood begins to drip from the ceiling, wind blows through the room, and soon she's being tossed about much the same as the woman in the first scene. She's slammed against the wall, the roof, and eventually flies through the closed window, dead. Now Em doesn't seem all that concerned about the death of her teacher. In fact, all she wants is her box back. She can't explain why she likes the box so much, but she does tell her father that her friend lives in the box, and that she talks to him. Clyde's definitely disturbed by this, and decides to throw the box away before it does anything else to Em. Now, when he arrives home, Em asks where the box is, and he tells her that he threw it out. She's furious, and demands the box back. But when he says no, she begins to insult him, calling her father out for all his insecurities. He's yelling at her to stop, but then she pretends to slap herself across the face, screaming for him to stop. Hannah comes out of her room just in time to see Em fleeing in fear from her father. So now Em's running down the street and she finds the box in the trash. She opens it and her friend starts to talk to her. We can't understand what it's saying, but it seems to be telling her to hurt her father. She tries to say no, but the spirit in the box takes over, and a dozen moths fly from it and pour down Em's mouth. She passes out cold on the ground just as Clyde arrives. Now Clyde picks her up and carries her home, only to find his wife and a bunch of police officers there already. Hannah called him, and now they all think that Clyde was beating Em. As expected, Clyde's banned from seeing Em and even Hannah. His wife and everyone else thinks he's a danger to him, and despite his protests, no one believes him. It becomes clear very quickly that something is very wrong with Em. Brett's in the garage when he sees Em standing there, staring at him, looking very creepy. She holds a tooth in her hand, and when Brett examines it, we see a creature of some sort moving inside Em's face. She manages to smother it, but a single tear rolls down her cheek. Now, sensing something's very wrong, Clyde drives back and collects the box from where he found Em the previous night. He then takes it to a college professor friend who examines the box and explains what little he can. Apparently, the box is of Polish origin and of Jewish make. It's covered in Hebrew inscriptions that say, Dybuk, a dislocated spirit. The box was literally built to contain evil spirits and keep them trapped. But this is also spoken with a tongue-in-cheek, and clearly, the professor believes it's superstition. Well, my friends, Clyde knows that this is not a superstition. He spends the afternoon researching Jewish spirits and exorcism, seeing videos that remind him a little too much of Em. Later, he visits Em while she's in bed at home, apparently sick. She's ignoring him, but he reads a passage from the Jewish Bible to her. Right away, things become spooky. The wind begins to blow through the room and knocks the Bible from Clyde's hand. Em looks at him, but it's not her. He asks who she is and what she wants with his girl, but the spirit ignores him. Now, with no other choice, Clyde makes a call to a Rabbi Tzedak and sets up a meeting in Brooklyn. So he drives all the way there and meets up with Tzedak, who takes him to see his father and a gathering of other Jewish officials. However, the moment that they see the box, they freak out, with a few even leaving. Clyde's asking for their help. He's begging, but they refuse, fearing the danger that comes from dealing with the Debuck. They claim that the Debuck only wants life and will kill anyone that tries to stop it. So a distraught Clyde leaves, thinking that he's on his own. But then Tzedak chases after him and explains that it's his duty to help if another life is in danger. So that night, Stephanie's at home when she hears something strange coming from the kitchen. She goes to check it out, only to find M on all four by the fridge eating red meat raw. Stephanie's asking what she's doing, and M screams at her to leave. And she's starting to speak in a strange hissing voice, telling Stephanie that
M isn't here.
She smashes the glass on the ground, sneaks around her mother, and looks as if she's about to attack her with a shard of glass. But M seems to take control, resisting the urge and collapsing in her mother's arms. Now, Stephanie's distraught, but Brett seems to think everything's okay. He suggests taking M to a specialist that he knows, framing it as a family trip, Stephanie nodding in agreement. But the next day, however, as Brett's packing up the car to leave, he spots M watching him. She's looking disheveled, possessed, and as he approaches her, he feels blood inside his mouth, and his teeth start falling out by the handful. So he's terrified, jumps in the car, and drives off. M collapses on the ground in a heap. Now, driving back from Brooklyn, Tzedak explains that in order for them to lure that demon out of M and back into the box, they need to know its name. Clyde said that he checked the entire box and he can't find a name anywhere. Tzedak examines the box, but then smashes the mirror, revealing the hidden name of the demon, Abizu. So now we have Stephanie taking in M for an MRI scan. And as the scan begins, the equipment begins to flutter and stall. The techs think it's a small technical error, but Hannah's watching on the monitor, and she sees something. It's hard to tell what it is, but the longer she watches, she notices a face inside of M. The face of a demon. It's around now that the machines crash out, but Stephanie saw it too, and she rushes to pull her daughter out of the machine. Clyde arrives at the hospital, and unlike last time, everyone's glad to see him. There's no need to explain what's going on, as they saw the MRI. Clyde tells him that Tzedak is here to help, and that's good enough for them. They carry M upstairs to a spare area in the hospital where no one will disturb him. They lie her down, light a bunch of candles, and prepare for the exorcism. It starts out well, and when nothing bad happens, they think it's over. But then all hell breaks loose. M attacks Tzedak, strangling him as Clyde and his wife try to tear her free. She then jumps to the ground and tells her father to F off. Clyde's begging the demon to take him instead and leave his little girl. But M turns and flees through the hospital, with Clyde chasing after her. He catches her in the morgue. At first, M stands back under some mood lighting, sobbing and pretending to reach out for her father. He approaches slowly and warily. And when the lights are shut out, she's suddenly on top of him. She attacks him and he screams for the demon to leave her body now. And a few moments later, Tzedak and the others enter the room. The lights are back on and M is sobbing in her father's arms. Everything seems all right, but Tzedak knows better. He screams for the demon to reveal itself. And a moment later, it does. It is now taking over Clyde's body. Tzedak begins to chant. Clyde slides across the room. Lights flash, people screaming, and the demon can be seen crawling out of his body, across the ground, going towards the others. More screaming as Tzedak chants, willing the creature back into the box, and then nothing. The lights are back on. It's silent. The demon appears to be banished back inside the box. And indeed, everything is all right. M's okay, Clyde's okay, family okay. They spent the night together and Stephanie walks to find Clyde in the kitchen making them breakfast. They smile at one another and we get the sense that everything's all right. Tzedak calls Clyde from the car. Clyde thanks him for what he did and he explains that he'll take the box back to his father to decide what to do with it. And just as he hangs up the phone, his car is sideswiped by a truck, throwing the box out from the car and across the road, free to be collected by a random passerby once more. So this was a recap of the film The Possession, produced by Lionsgate and released back in 2012. Directed by Ole Bornadel, it stars Jeffrey Dean Morgan, Kira Sedgwick, and Natasha Callis. This movie's full of creepy moments, What scene scared you the most? Let us know with the hashtag Cinema Recap in the comments.